Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. We've received apologies this morning from Alex Rowley, and I welcome Jackie Bailey, who's attending as his substitute. Can I just take a moment to recognise and reflect the third anniversary of when we went into lockdown and send our condolences to all of those that lost a loved one or a family member to COVID-19. This morning we will conclude our evidence taking on our inquiry into long COVID, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting Hamza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, John Harden, the Deputy National Clinical Director, Ashley Simpson, the Team Leader of the Planning and Quality Division, and Christopher Doyle, who is Senior Policy Manager in the Clinical Priorities Unit. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any short opening remarks?
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to you and to committee members. Can I start exactly in the place that you did and offer my condolences, of course, to those that lost loved ones and continue, I'm afraid, to lose loved ones throughout the course of the pandemic. Can I also reflect, as we will do in the course of this conversation, that, of course, many people who first contracted COVID and suffered from COVID, now suffering from the long-term effects of COVID to this very day and the debilitating effects it's having on them. I am grateful for the opportunity to appear before this committee to discuss the impacts of long COVID and provide some information about the steps that we are taking to support the health and well-being of people with this condition. Long COVID is, as committee members know, it's a term that encapsulates quite a wide range of over 200 different symptoms. They can be highly variable between people, and at present the underlying causes are poorly understood. What is well understood, though, is of course that for those adults, those children, those young people most severely affected, those symptoms have a significant impact on their physical health, on their mental health, through to education and employment and everything in between. I've heard this myself, of course, when meeting with people with long COVID, and from those in our NHS who support them. From those severely affected, for those that are severely affected, life undoubtedly is extremely challenging. Around the world, science has begun the work of trying to find out not just an explanation, but the treatments for long COVID. The science is still very much in its early stages. Proven, safe, evidence-based treatments are still, unfortunately, in their infancy. Scotland is contributing to this worldwide research effort. Meantime, we are taking steps to test new ways to support people. We know that the evolving understanding of the disease and the current lack of effective treatments can understandably contribute to distress. And we understand the needs for supportive care that recognises the challenges that are being faced by people who are living with these symptoms. At the moment, the clinical guidance recommends providing treatment where possible for the specific symptoms that people do have, or to provide a rehabilitative approach to help people manage the impact of these symptoms and the impact that it has on their day-to-day lives. This care and support is provided through the full range of services delivered across our NHS. People can access GP assessments in a setting close to their home. GPs can then refer to community rehabilitation services or secondary care pathways such as respiratory or cardiology where appropriate. These are the individual services best placed to investigate and support people with symptoms they may require as a result of long COVID. However, let me be clear that I know that people's experiences of accessing and indeed navigating support have been challenging. There is certainly room for improvement. There will be no challenge for me to that premise. That's why we've committed to investing £10 million in a long COVID support fund and have made an initial £3 million available from the fund this year. Rather than mandate one specific model, we are supporting NHS boards to innovate and plan based on local needs and local infrastructure. The Long COVID Support Fund is targeted additional resource for NHS boards to increase the capacity of existing services, develop these into more clearly defined pathways and provide a more coordinated experience for those accessing support. And that's something we've heard from long COVID sufferers time and time again. Amongst the approaches that's being tested is to achieve these outcomes through a single point of access for assessment and coordinated support for services, including physiotherapy and occupational therapy. Along with our support of these initiatives underway in boards, the Scottish Government has also delivered a clinical guideline implementation support note. That's to help GPs effectively provide assessment and referral to people with long COVID. We have a dedicated microsite on NHS Inform with key information for those people that are suffering from long COVID, a marketing campaign to raise awareness of long COVID, and a £2.5 million funding for 9 Scottish-led research projects to better understand long COVID. And of course, the establishment, as committee knows, of the National Strategic Network, which brings together those with lived experience, clinical experts, and those working on local service response. I'll close, convener, by saying that long COVID is undoubtedly a considerable challenge. There's still much to do, still much to learn, and there is improvements to be made. But we have an opportunity for our healthcare system to adapt, to learn, and that is going to be based on the best evidence that is available. I very much welcome your inquiry of this issue and the opportunity to discuss it and, of course, take questions from members over the course of this morning.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And can I thank you for the update yesterday of the reallocation of unspent funds on the 10 new projects that are being led by the third sector. If we can turn to questions, and if I could begin with the first question. During this inquiry, the committee has been really keen to hear from people with lived experience of long COVID, and we've taken evidence from a lot of groups suffering from long COVID, and we also received over 500 responses to our call for views from the general public. And if I could share a comment from Jane Omerud, who is from Long COVID Scotland. What the government is saying and the reality for people with lived experience do not match up. I agree that different things are happening in different health boards and that consistency is an issue. I know that everywhere is different and geography is different, but there needs to be an overall consistency and shared principles of what should look like in each health board. And as a committee, that's one of the things become evident as we've been going through this inquiry, is that all the health boards are doing different things. And I appreciate that some boards have experienced delays in recruiting posts to implement pathways to take care of people with long COVID. But can I ask, are there any plans to develop guidance for NHS boards on specific pathways for people with long COVID?
So can I thank you for that question? Can I thank Jane for her comment? Because Jane is somebody who's been on the meetings that I've been in when I've met with those who are suffering from the effects of long COVID. So that is the purpose of having that national strategic network there. That's why we have those who are providing those local services, those with lived experience, as well as, of course, our clinical experts who contribute to that, is to get that level of consistency. And if you look at, and I'm certain the committee will have looked and pored over the detail of the funding allocation for each NHS health board, you will see that many of the health boards are looking to get that single point of access, but also to have those pathways better developed. And where that works well, so for me, if I looked at NHS Lanarkshire as a good model, it's clear that other health boards are looking towards that model and trying to get that level of consistency. Jane is not wrong. There is a lack of consistency, a difficulty in accessing pathways, and that's why the implementation support note is so important, because when somebody does go to their GP, which will be the first port of call for, if not everyone, then the vast overwhelming majority, then there is literally a flowchart which can tell a GP where the referral pathways should be, what are the other support services that are available. So yes, I mean, in short, that work is very much underway. It is one of the key areas in which the funding is looking to support. But I take Jane's point in its entirety. We're trying to get a balance, I suppose, I would say, between absolutely having that national consistency, which is important, but that doesn't mean necessarily one model fits all, and letting local health boards. So Highlands are a great example. We all know about the geography of the Highlands. We know how disparate the population is, etc., etc. So they have a good virtual model actually in Highland, which works well for and they're further developing that. But clearly, that is one model that is the NHS Highland have developed, but that is suitable to the local needs. So you know, there will not be a blanket approach, but I take Jane's absolute point, and she's correct in this, that there has to be consistency in terms of access to pathways.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's helpful. Can I ask what actions has the strategic network taken to improve the consistency of care for people with long COVID across Scotland? And also what oversight of the strategic network does the Scottish Government have?
So we're obviously involved in the strategic network, and let me ask some of my officials to come in and add some detail on that. So the strategic network is a model that has been used, for example, for our trauma networks. It's a model that's well known, well tested, and has some really positive outcomes. Essentially, what it has done is brought together the key partners, the clinical experts, those who are delivering the local services, and of course those with lived experience. And some of the actions that's taken, and we can provide you more detail on this, is to really work with health boards to bring forward those referral pathways, particularly around the rehabilitative pathways, which we know are working well in some health board areas, but clearly need more work in other health board areas. It's also, what has come out of that, of course, is one of the core issues, I've already referenced this, but one of the core issues that a number of GPs, those in primary care, have said, we do not have the information around where to refer to, for example, and that's why the development of the implementation support note has been really, really important. So there's a whole load of key actions that have come out of the National Strategic Network. There will be more actions that will come out of it, but the value in that network is that it brings those three groups crucially together in order to improve the services for long COVID. But I don't know whether or not any of my John or Ashley or any of my colleagues wish to come in on the strategic network at all. Chris probably is best placed given their involvement at a closer level.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. So I would agree that the strategic network is a key tool for us to support improvement of the level of consistency at a national level. The strategic network brings together boards to share information and learning around the models of care that they're developing and implementing, and I think will be a key to helping us learn and evaluate the models of care that they're delivering in order to make sure that we learn and capture that information. The other thing I'd like to add is that the strategic network has a clinical and subject matter expert group, which is collating information on current pathways of care for people with long COVID, and has indicated that it will support the development of standardised guidance in addition to that work, if that is appropriate.
Did anyone else want to come in on that question? No? Okay. On speaking to many of those suffering from long COVID, one of the issues is the prevalence of COVID in still being in the community, and it's a major concern. And I note the Scottish Government is currently undertaking the autumn-winter COVID-19 booster program, but as of the 12th of March, we've only seen just over 2 million people take up that winter booster, whereas we had 4.5 million for the first booster and just over 4,300,000 for the second booster. So there seems to be a bit of an apathy from the general public to take up the boosters over the time. Firstly, can I ask, does the Scottish Government still believe it's important to continue to take up the offers of the vaccine programme? And if so, what public health messaging is out there to encourage people about the importance of having the booster?
Yes, thanks for that. You're absolutely right. When it comes to the vaccine, we were always concerned and have been concerned that there may be an apathy and a vaccine fatigue that may well kick in among certain groups and certain cohorts. It's really important when you see the breakdown of the data, actually. Among some cohorts, there's not been that fatigue. So if you look at, for example, our older population, if you look at those within residents within a care home, for example, we still have good levels of uptake in terms of the vaccine. Where we saw some drop-off is, for example, in the cohorts 50 to 64 age group, for example. So and we had some concern about the uptake in relation to social care staff, and we put a lot of effort working with the likes of Scottish Care and others to try to see if we could boost those numbers. Still worth saying, of course, that our uptake rates for autumn winter vaccine are still the highest in the UK, which is a positive, and we continue to work with them on a Four Nations basis to see what we can do on a coordinated basis. So yes, we'll continue to do that. We also have, as you know, we had last year COVID Sense campaign as well, reminding people of good behaviours, what to do if they have the symptoms of COVID, for example, around good hygiene, good ventilation, etc., etc. So these will continue to be the case. That will continue to make the case in that regard, as the immediate impacts of COVID are not so evident, are not in our news 24/7. That will be an important piece of work for us to do, because ultimately, if we can reduce the number of people suffering from COVID, of course, then we'll hopefully reduce the numbers impacted by long COVID. But look, I couldn't agree more with the premise of your question, which is we should be doing everything in our gift that we possibly can to increase the vaccination rates.
Thank you. And just moving on to my last question, and I know that recruitment is a problem in the NHS at the moment. But how can health boards be supported to recruit for long COVID posts, and to what extent would recurrent funding help address the recruitment issues highlighted by the health boards?
Yeah, so I think this is a really good question. Recruitment is undoubtedly and continues to be a challenge. What we are doing with health boards is making it clear, of course, that the funding, the £10 million funding, which is on top of course, their core allocation, that funding will be available throughout the next few years. So making that clear to them. We know that there has been some issues around recruitment. We're working with the boards to see what more we can do in relation to those recruitment challenges. So we'll continue to do that board by board. Those challenges will be different. Again, the challenges that our colleagues in NHS Grampian face will be different to what Greater Glasgow and Clyde face. So those recruitment challenges undoubtedly are one of the reasons why the full £3 million hasn't been able to be spent this year. But I've made it very, very clear to health boards that £10 million funding will still be available over the course of the next few years.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and welcome to your colleagues. Just to really follow on from the line of questioning from the Convener, we've heard a lot of evidence from long COVID sufferers during the course of this inquiry about the issues they have trying to access services. And I just want to read you, if I can, an email we had a couple of weeks ago from a long COVID sufferer in Aberdeenshire. I won't use his name, I don't have permission. But just to give you a flavour of some of the feedback we've had as a committee. So this individual says, recounting his experience, "I've just been forced to make a private GP appointment due to the complete lack of support from the NHS. Actually, it's worse than that, as my current GP surgery is utterly dismissive. He has a diagnosis of long COVID. He says, in December, I was forced to take a day off work. I contacted the surgery. My GP told me there's nothing to be done for long COVID. Current NICE guidelines state we are not to prescribe pain relief for chronic pain, and you have to take responsibility and self-manage." Now, you know, clearly that's not acceptable, is it, that that's the response individuals who have a diagnosis of long COVID are getting from their GPs?
I agree with you, and I wonder if it's the same person I met from Aberdeenshire. Again, I won't say the name because I had a very similar experience from a young person in Aberdeenshire who felt that their GP was dismissive. But actually, I've heard it from people not just in Aberdeenshire, but in many other parts of the country. And that's why not just the NICE guideline, but the implementation support note, which we can give you further detail in writing through the convener if you want, gives that level of detail of the referral pathways that are available. It's why we've put so much work through the strategic network into the education tools that are available for GPs. And I do highlight the evidence that was the written evidence that was given by the RCGP to this very committee and to this very inquiry, where the RCGP, and I agree with them, do believe that primary care and GPs are the first port of call and the best are best placed to give that holistic assessment before then perhaps onward referral. But that is why so much work has gone into, and again, I'm more than happy to provide some of the detail on this in writing, but so much work has gone into trying to assist our GP colleagues who are facing a number of challenges in relation to the pandemic around where those referral pathways are. So we have the implementation support note. We have an education strategy to raise awareness of long COVID. We have NHS Education for Scotland have their learning platform, TURAS, which I suspect members will know about. It contains a video and webinar content on long COVID. So there's a lot in that space that is largely trying to work closely with our primary care and GP colleagues to ensure that they know the correct pathways that are available.
Okay, thanks for that, and I appreciate it's a work in progress, and we've heard this over a long period of time, but the feedback we keep getting from people is the experience on the ground is still lacking. Now, this individual says he's had to go private. Now, again, this has been a consistent theme we've had from long COVID sufferers, where people have had to go private to try and access a GP who's got expertise in the area. Now, that's fine for those who can afford it. Many people can't afford it. So we've created, have we not, a two-tier system. And isn't that unacceptable?
I don't want a two-tier system. We've heard this in other areas of the health service where, for example, people have waited for elective care. And again, I won't rehearse the reasons why we're in the position that we're in, and they felt they've had to go private. That, to me, is not what I want. As Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, I want everybody to be able to access the services on the NHS. Suppose I go back to my comments in my opening remarks, is that the science around treatment of long COVID and the symptoms of long COVID is still in its infancy. And I think everybody around the table would probably accept that. There's not one treatment that we can give. There are a number of treatments to try to help with the symptoms or some of the symptoms of long COVID. But far too often I've heard from long COVID sufferers that when they go to primary care, primarily when they go to their GP, they are just either passed from pillar to post and there is not that single point of access. And for me, that is why the funding that we have given to health boards, I think I can safely say the majority of the health boards are using that funding, certainly significant, a number of them are using that funding to create that single point of access so that an individual isn't passed from pillar to post. But look, to answer your question, of course, I don't want people to have to feel that their only option is to go private. And that's why we need to improve the services that we have.
Yeah, so you've talked about the single point of access. That's a very important point. We've had that in a lot of evidence that we've heard. We also heard from a lot of long COVID sufferers. They would like to see long COVID clinics established in Scotland to provide specifically that service. So where is your thinking around long COVID clinics being dedicated and being established in Scotland, as happens in other parts of the UK?
Yeah, and we do look at the other models. So I think, for example, Dr. Sanjesh Gohani has mentioned the Hertfordshire model before. So we've looked at other long COVID clinic models around the UK. So for me, I go back to the sign and the NICE guideline on long COVID. You know, one model would not fit all areas, and I think we all probably accept that. What I would say is that I agree quite strongly with the RCGP in this and the written evidence to the committee, and perhaps I can just quote it directly. You know, talk about long COVID, it often requires generalist skills to treat, but most can be fully managed in primary care, and the GP is best placed to provide this holistic approach. The RCGP go on to say there's an increased risk that patients presenting with long COVID symptoms may have instead another cardiac or respiratory condition, which may have similar or even identical symptoms. Patients need a GP assessment and investigation rather, and this is the important part, rather than being funneled inappropriately into a clinic that is designed for one condition and then require further investigation and alternative management. So I'm not in principle opposed. I never have been. I've said this from day one. I've never been in principle opposed to long COVID clinics. And that's why I've asked my team to go out and look at, for example, the Hertfordshire model. For me, I suppose it's in effect trying to cut out the middleman or the middle person. It is, you know, we have GPs, if they have the appropriate referral pathways through the implementation support note, getting directly into then a COVID rehabilitation service within, you know, Lanarkshire, as the example I keep using. That, to me, is a better model than a GP then having to refer, for example, to a long COVID clinic, who then would have to refer on to maybe another pathway. So I'm not opposed in principle. What I'm trying to do is allow local health boards to design the service that meets their local need.
I suppose the key question, if you know, I was a long COVID sufferer in front of you now, I'd be saying, this is fine. You're talking about developing pathways. You're talking about, you recognise there are issues. When is this actually going to get to a state where we've actually got the services that people need?
Yeah, and it's a very fair question. So again, in some areas, we do absolutely have that service. So in the Highland service I've talked about, there's been 100 referrals, and Lanarkshire, well over 500 referrals being made. Where we're lacking is that single point of access and ensuring that there is that connect between the primary care and the secondary care services. And that is exactly, as you can see, what the funding is looking to do. So I've got every faith that we're going to see more and more health boards developing these services in a much more consistent manner. Some are already doing that, absolutely. There are some who are using this funding and giving us timescales in relation to when they'll have those pathways more fully developed. But a Murdo Fraser essentially hits the nail on the head. That is the number one issue that comes up. Long COVID sufferers time and time again. It all sounds good, but is it consistently working across the country? The answer to that is not yet, but that is what we're working on.
Well, maybe that'll be a job for your successor in your as Health Secretary, if you're no longer in that role. Who knows? Can I just ask one more follow-up question?
Second person to sack me in about a few weeks now.
Second. Ask a follow-up question, convener. Slightly different topic. You wrote to the committee yesterday with a list of funding that has been allocated. This is within the current financial year. Now, there's various funding streams that are announced for third sector organisations, which is, you know, all very, very welcome. But the total here, the 334,000 that's been allocated, is that money that was basically unspent in this year's budget?
Yes, in short. Yeah, that was so there was a £3 million initially allocated. There was an underspend, I think, Kilos can be right, about £1.1 million of that. We then went out to third sector organisations because obviously health boards could not spend that money because of recruitment challenges. What we've given a clear, absolute guarantee of is, of course, that £10 million additional, that £10 million funding. The profile of that may well change. It won't be necessarily three. Or just over £3 million per year. So yes, to answer your question, in short, that is part of that underspend.
Okay, and the funds that have been allocated, obviously they're within this financial year. Do these organisations need to spend that money by the end of the financial year, or can they roll that over?
I think it has to be spent in this financial year, certainly the work. They have to begin the work in spending that money this financial year. Forgive me, I can get you absolute clarity on that post the committee. But these are all, they're essentially building upon existing projects that they already have underway.
Yeah, because the end of the financial year is only 2 weeks away, so it doesn't give them very long to
the money was
spend the money.
Distributed before the letter was sent to you. And,
How long before?
I would need to check, actually. I'm not sure if my colleagues know exactly when that money was given to those organisations. But essentially, when we worked with those third sector organisations, made it clear this was coming as part of the underspend. The health boards could not spend, and were they confident that they would be able to meet the criteria for that spend? And that's why the amounts are, in some cases, relatively small, as you'll see, and in some cases, larger than that. But that's why they are building upon existing programmes that already exist. But I suppose the fundamental point is that £10 million we've given a guarantee to health boards and others will be available over the course of the next few years.
OK. All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to Jackie Bailey, please?
Thank you. And can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments about improving services? Can I just pick up where you left off? You said there was a £1.1 million underspend, but the allocation that I have in the table is for 334,000. Where's the rest of the money being spent?
So it'll be reprofiled over the next few years.
Oh, OK. So you're carrying that bit forward?
Forward.
Fine. OK. Given that it was less than £3 million that was actually allocated to health boards as part of that £10 million over 3 years, the Cabinet Secretary will, of course, recall that at the point you made the allocation, there were 74,000 people affected by long COVID. Of course, now, unfortunately, there are 175,000 people affected. Do you intend to increase the overall resource available?
It's a really fair question to ask. So, of course, I would look to see where we can provide even more support. I suppose the point I would make about the long COVID fund, which I know is well understood by colleagues around the table, is that is on top of course, the, well, in this financial year, £18 billion, next financial year, £19 billion. We are giving to health boards, well, giving to the NHS and social care, and of course a chunk of that to our health boards. And it's worth saying that when you look at our frontline spend per head in Scotland, is of course higher than, for example, the parts of the UK, £323 per person higher than in England, for example. And if I take that Lanarkshire model, and I keep going back to that, where I've seen it firsthand and spoken to some people who've benefited from that service, when that rehabilitation service was up and running, of course, they didn't wait for the allocation from the £10 million long COVID fund. They used their health board allocation to create that team to hire those and recruit those multidisciplinary team members, and they're the ones who are providing that support to long COVID sufferers. So hopefully that gives you some reassurance.
It does indeed, but that's not been the case in every health board across Scotland.
Agreed.
And so we have a postcode lottery. In May 2022, by that point, NHS England had allocated £224 million to support assessment and treatment of long COVID. £90 million was in 22-23 alone. Our share of that in Barnett consequentials would produce £21.7 million in Scotland. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary where that money has gone, and would he use some of that to enhance the COVID services that are currently a postcode lottery on the ground? For the benefit of your officials, those report, the stats are from Spice and the House of Commons Library.
Yeah, no, I accept that. For me, of course, every single one of our health and social care consequentials that comes our way is spent in health and social care. That's been a commitment of ours in this government for a number of years now. What I would do is look to see where we can possibly increase our funding for specifically long COVID. But I go back to the point I made to Jackie Bailey a moment ago, and that is that, of course, our spending, our frontline spending for health per head is higher than in other parts of the UK. And yes, the long COVID support fund is important to increase, supplement some of the work that's already ongoing. But it is just that, it's supplementary, it's complementary to the funding that is already spent by health boards, not just in Lanarkshire, I've given that example, but right across the country. So I'm more than happy to explore, certainly in my role, I'm certain whoever's in this role after me will look to explore very much how that funding, if it can be increased.
I will take that as a commitment from the incoming First Minister to increase long COVID funding. Thank you so much. You've made my day. Can I take you to the primary care? Well, I heard that. Can I take you to the Primary Care Improvement Fund? Because, of course, in your long COVID paper published in September 2021, you said that the Primary Care Improvement Fund will continue to support and expand the range of professional roles in primary care that play a key role in the provision of services that can support people with long COVID. And so we all agree. However, the fund was cut by £65 million in the emergency budget review. Did this not have an impact on the ability of primary care and community-based support for long COVID services?
In terms of long COVID services, that is a further assessment we would have to do, but I accept entirely the premise that you cannot reprofile money from one area and not have an impact, particularly when I had to reprofile £400 million of funding within the health and social care budget. That clearly had an impact. It would be foolish. I'd be insulting your intelligence and the intelligence of other people listening and watching if I didn't say that was the case. What I would say to Jackie Bailey, and I do know she understands this, that, of course, these were decisions that were being made because our budget was so badly impacted by peak inflation at that point, made the health and social care budget worth about £1.2 billion less, but also because we wanted to make sure we were giving a fair pay deal to our NHS workers, something that I know Jackie Bailey supports fully in its entirety. To do that, we had to reprofile. And that's why I was very keen that when we set the budget for 23-24, of course, we made sure that we put that money back into primary care. But it's absolutely the case that when we reprofile that amount of money, we will try to do it in a way that has minimal impact, but of course it has impact.
You've taken me neatly to my final question, which is about health and social care staff. We know that they were the ones who were on the front line of the pandemic, initially operating without adequate PPE. These are the people that are suffering from long COVID, and their employment protection for COVID was removed. Now these staff are on half pay, some on no pay, some have actually been forced to leave their employment. I've been contacted by a staff member from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and she said that their objective was simply to get her out the door and quit her job. After 35 years in the NHS, she feels very angry and very let down. What can the Cabinet Secretary do to protect our health and social care workers who have long COVID from being dismissed by their employers?
Yeah, and again, these are obviously individual employment issues. We took an approach, as Jackie Bailey will know, in around long COVID that other nations took right across the UK, including Labour run Wales, Conservative run England, and of course the approach is taken in Northern Ireland around the employment and the additional support we could give for those that were suffering from long COVID. Actually, we extended that beyond where other countries in the UK decided to withdraw some of that support. So these are important employment issues. I know there are various members' bills, for example, such as Mark Griffin's members' bill around industrial injury. There are calls for long COVID to be prescribed as a disability. And, of course, under the Equality Act, it's more the impact of a condition and the debilitating impact of a condition as opposed to necessarily the condition itself, which has to be prescribed. Therefore, it could be that long COVID and the effects of long COVID could mean that somebody then has a disability which would impact their ability to get certain benefits and social security benefits. So I'll continue to look at this matter. It is a challenge because we have to make sure particularly where employment law is, of course, reserved. We have to make sure that long COVID, we understand the unique impacts of long COVID and the fact that there aren't treatments for, there are some treatments for some symptoms, but not treatment for others. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we have to make sure that is employment law is being applied in a way that is consistent across conditions.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley,
please.
Thank you, convener, and welcome to the committee, folks. Can I just go back a little bit? I want to come on to paediatrics in a minute, but can I just go back a little bit, convener? Is that all right? We talked, Murdo Fraser talked about GPs, and you cited it yourself. If a GP doesn't accept that there is an issue, and you're a long COVID sufferer, you don't have the energy to fight the system. One thing we keep hearing from long COVID sufferers is that they are drained. So if they go to a GP who is actually dismissing them, what is the route for them to get either a second opinion, or is there a way of compelling GPs, and I don't know if that's possible, compelling them to accept that this is actually a condition that people are suffering from?
So ultimately, of course, it's not for government or health secretaries or ministers to override clinical opinion and clinical judgment. That's got to be up to the individual clinicians. I'm really upset when I hear that people have been dismissed. You know, it's got echoes for me of a number of those mesh survivors that we've all interacted with, I suspect, yeah, who, in their own words, feel that they were dismissed by clinicians time and time again. So I'm really concerned, and that's why so much of our work has been around the educational tools that we can provide for our frontline primary care workers, who, by the way, do an incredible job and under really difficult circumstances. I suspect all of us would agree with that, particularly given the effects of the pandemic. So that's why so much work has gone into the educational tools, into the implementation support. No, I'd be really disappointed if I was to hear a recent example of that being the case. I don't know how recent example was that Dr. Fraser gave or that you've given, but I'd be really upset if there was a recent example of people being dismissed by the GPs because the amount of work that we put in. But I don't know, I mean, Dr. John Harden might want to come in if there's anything else to add on that front. And we've been taking a lot of advice from GPs. I think Dr. Amy Smalls has given you evidence, for example. She's the one that's attended some of the meetings that we've had on this. But John, yeah, I don't know if you want to...
Yeah, thank you. I mean, as a clinician, I'm sorry that that's people's experience, and I hope that's extremely the minority. Or not happening now, as Cabinet Secretary has just said. We have done a lot of work through the implementation support note, work with the Royal College of GPs, work with the NHS Education for Scotland to try and raise the awareness and the education levels within healthcare providers to make sure that they have the knowledge to recognise these symptoms and signs. The difficulty, as a practising clinician myself, and I'm not a GP, I'm an emergency medicine consultant, but as a practising doctor, we're pattern recognisers, effectively, so that's what we do. We listen to people's stories, we look at their symptoms and signs, and we try to piece together what we think is going on in the context with which the patient's presenting. And in those circumstances, sometimes we get it wrong, sometimes, the majority of times, we hopefully get it right. But unfortunately, sometimes we're led down a route that may not mean that we've jumped to that conclusion of long COVID initially. That's not a bad thing. It shouldn't stop us delivering treatment for patient symptoms, but sometimes it means that we want to exclude other potentially more sinister conditions first. And with the breadth of symptoms that we see with long COVID, it cross-cuts across so many other conditions. It's very difficult for clinicians to know whether it is specifically long COVID or not. And the danger here is that clinicians are sometimes not wanting to jump to the conclusion of long COVID before they've excluded other aspects.
Okay, and I should put on the record that this is a tiny minority of people that I'm talking about, and I'm not entirely sure where we are in terms of people now not getting that. So I just wanted to clarify that point. The other thing is that this partnership between third sector and the NHS, myself and my colleague John Mason attended a chest, heart and stroke event actually in this room, and it was excellent. Is there room for you to expand that partnership more as we go forward? Because clearly the NHS are under a huge amount of pressure, and if other areas of society, third sector groups, are able to help, surely that would be something we would want to do?
Yes, I mean, the short answer is yes to that. We've already provided some additional funding to chest, heart and stroke Scotland, but I'm very, very keen actually to see what more they can do. You'll know, of course, the unique digital pathway that they're working with in relation to NHS Lothian. That's what NHS Lothian want to use their allocation of that £10 million funding. So I'm very keen to see the evaluation of that and to make sure that we do not suffer from what I often call pilotitis. If it's working well, let's make sure we get it rolled out even further. So I'd be keen to see how that particular programme in NHS Lothian is working and the evaluation of that.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to quickly go on to paediatrics just now, because you mentioned the children who have got long COVID in your opening remarks, and I have to say some of the most harrowing stuff we've listened to has come from parents of young kids who are suddenly completely debilitated. So what pathways are in the healthcare services are available for children with long COVID right now?
Yeah, can I agree with your assessment and your description, I should say, that some of the most harrowing testimony has been from young children. And I think it's worth paying particular tribute to Helen Goss, who I suspect is known by most people here in terms of what she does with long COVID kids. Scotland, she is a force of nature, but is, you know, dealing with her own personal circumstances and has helped a lot of families of those who have children and young people who are suffering the effects of long COVID. So I want to pay a particular tribute to the work that she does. And she would be the first to say that we've got further work to do in this particular area. So to answer your question directly, for children, young people with symptoms of long COVID, assessment and initial investigation is still provided by the primary care team. Primary care clinicians can, of course, then refer to occupational or physiotherapy for further advice or support. When it comes to that implementation support note, so I've referred it to a couple of times, that support note, which is there for GPs, it's got the referral pathways there, the other support that exists, that was developed in consultation with the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health. So it does set out that where self-management, for example, is not effective and there's a significant impact on a young person or child's education or the quality of life, they should be referred to general paediatric services for investigation. So the funding that we've made available to NHS boards, that £10 million that I've referenced numerous times already, that does include strengthening services for young people with long COVID. And one example of that would be Greater Glasgow and Clyde. So Greater Glasgow and Clyde, through the letter I think that I sent you earlier, they're recruiting additional paediatric occupational therapist support to support young people, to support children and indeed their families. I should also mention, finally, perhaps, that the National Strategic Network, again, which I've referenced a couple of times now during this session, they're progressing a dedicated work stream that brings together those clinical experts, those with lived experience, to identify needs and priority actions that are specifically for children and young people too.
One of the gaps that we've also heard about is that transition from children to adolescents and adult services. Are you doing any work around making sure that that transition is working for young people who are going from children's care to adult care?
I think that's exactly why the strategic network is so important, because it's looking, it's got those dedicated work streams, but what it does is it brings them all at the national level together. And so where we're trying to improve services for adults, for children, we make sure there's no gaps in between if there are those young people who are in that transitionary phase. I have to say it's not an issue that's been raised with me specifically around long COVID. It's an issue that presents itself in many other parts of the health and social care system, as you'd imagine. It's not an issue that's been raised with me particularly in relation to long COVID, but I'm happy to take that one up with long COVID Scotland, but also long COVID kids as well.
Okay, thank you. How much time have we got?
We've got time.
Grand. Okay, educational support for children and young people with long COVID. Is there a consistent offering across Scotland?
So I think, again, it's an area where we want to get better in terms of education, because I've met with a number of young people who suffered from long COVID. In fact, it was just outside of this parliament, and actually we had a meeting a number of months ago now, and the educational support, some families were telling me the school was excellent, others telling me not so much. So this is why it's really important that I'm having those conversations, as you can imagine I am, with the Education Secretary, and we're bringing in education officials, as well as Fair Work officials, going back to Jackie Bailey's question, around employment as well. So we are working cross-government in that regard, but fair to say that it's continued work in progress.
OK, I'm going to move on to theme six at the moment. In my previous life as a farmer, prevention was always better than cure. We are now dealing with the effects of people having been infected, but how are we going to stop it continuing to circulate? If the convener's point at the start of this session was that we've only got 2+ million people who have taken up the booster, what more can we do? Is it more messaging? Is it how do we get over that vaccine fatigue? Just to remind people that this disease hasn't gone away and that there are people who are still suffering from it and people still dying from it.
Yeah, I think it's a really good point. And I think for me, when it comes to the vaccine, we still should say that it's been a really successful vaccination programme. Mm-hmm. You're right, if we compare it to previous programmes, you can see where the uptake level is. But generally speaking, in terms of if we compared it to other vaccination programmes, we have done incredibly well. And I want to thank all those, the kind of army of vaccinators that we have right up and down the country for what they've done in this regard. For me, it's about everything you've said. It's about not just the vaccination. That is the game changer, though. That has got to be front and centre of our response to COVID and to hopefully reducing the numbers of people who contract it, but you know, lessening the effects of COVID as best we possibly can. Continued work around ventilation, and that's in educational settings, that's in work settings. There's still work to do in that regard. It is about the messaging. The messaging is really important. I referenced the COVID Sense campaign that we've got, which is just reminding people about the measures they can take. So it's all of that. There's not one single answer, but clearly, you know, we are still also involved in work around surveillance as well. We continue to be vigilant should there be any other mutations or variations or variants of COVID, and continue to work on a four nations basis in that regard. And I know the UK continue to work internationally with global partners in that sense too. So there's not one answer to the question. There's multiple things that we have to do, and we'll keep that kind of regular drumbeat of campaigning, as well as, of course, vaccine, the next programme of the vaccine, in which we continue to take the advice of the JCVI.
So we know that the ONS are going to be stopping doing their surveillance, but SEPA will continue to do theirs in the wastewater plants. Are you confident that that will give us enough data to know how much disease is actually circulating in the community?
So I think, again, we're getting the balance there. I mean, we'll continue to work on a four nations basis with the UK government in relation to the various surveillance measures that we have. Wastewater sampling is very effective. It's giving you that real-time data in a way that other data doesn't necessarily do so. So we'll continue to ensure we have that. It's also fair to say we're getting to that almost transition phase. So we had the height of the pandemic. We're going from that transition from pandemic to endemic. And as we do that, of course, we will end up treating COVID in the way that we treat other viral infections. But that will be a transitionary phase, and surveillance will be an important part of that, as surveillance is for other viral infections too.
Thank you, Gabriel.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, please.
Convener, good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning,
morning.
To your colleagues. I just move a point forward that Jim Fairley made earlier around education. I'd like to talk maybe about education of our healthcare professionals around at long COVID. Now, GPs are supposed to have built into their day or into their week a certain amount of time for CPD. But I'm harping back to my time in the Health and Sport Committee, where every time we did an investigation into any kind of condition, it was around we need to educate our, you know, our healthcare professionals in this particular condition. That's fine in, you know, theory, but we know that they're under incredible pressure at the moment, and so the reality is that CPD is probably the last thing on the list. So, with that in mind, how do we create a health service that is, you know, we've heard stories here of perhaps GPs' lack of knowledge potentially around CPD, around long COVID. So how do we allow them the time to breathe, if you pardon the expression, to take on that CPD?
I think it's such a good question. So it's an issue that I've been engaged with the BMA and the RCGP quite some time. So pre-pandemic, what traditionally would happen in many GP practices, as Brian Whittle probably knows, is they'd close on a Friday afternoon and NHS 24 would have an agreement to pick up any calls and inquiries that came to the GP practice, and that would give them the flexibility to do that, and of course their patient, patient's confidence that their calls would be picked up by somebody else. Not been able to do that, of course, in the course of the pandemic. And again, I don't suspect I need to tell Brian Whittle how much pressure even NHS 24 is under. So we've got to find another model, and that's what we're working on with the BMA and also the RCGP, because for me, that protected learning time, that CPD time, is absolutely pivotal. And it's really important for our trainee doctors. It's important for everybody, of course, but really important for me, for our trainee doctors in particular, and giving them the confidence to progress in a role as a general practitioner. So we're working absolutely on that. At the moment, it's because of the pressure that NHS 24 is under. GPs, you know, I've been into a GP practice not far from here, actually, where they're effectively having to use, you know, half an hour in the morning to go through some of their educational CPD, and that's not ideal. So practices are doing it in a way that suits them, as opposed to the model that was previously involving NHS 24. So we're working absolutely on that, and I've given a commitment to the RCGP and BMA to see what more we can do to support them in that regard.
Thank you. That's helpful. I wanted to go into, Scotland have got, you know, a world-renowned reputation in research, in medical research, and you know, quite rightly. I think where we potentially and we collect, you know, we've heard evidence in this committee of the collection of data. Again, pretty good at that. Where we fall down is the deployment of that data. And using that data to the best advantage. And I know the Cabinet Secretary and I share a bit of a, you know, an interest around IT, and we've discussed this before, but I think COVID and now long COVID has highlighted an issue around how we utilise that data and an IT system potentially that is not capable of using that data to its best advantage. So if we strip this right back to the start, aren't we in a position now where we should re-look at the way in which the IT system across our nation interact, or the different IT systems interact with each other, and so we can deploy that data to be most effective?
Yeah, and we do share an interest. I don't think I'm paraphrasing Brian Whittle when he described himself as a data geek, which I think is a data nerd, I think, is what he described himself as. But I am in the same vein. I think data is crucial and key to this. Mm. And actually, so many of the challenges that we faced across health and social care have been because we simply have not dismantled the barriers to data sharing effectively. And that's why I refer to the health and social care data strategy that we have. I'm certain I've offered, and forgive me, we've not had the chance to sit down, Brian Whittle and I, with my team, to go through that in great amounts of detail. I think he should meet with my officials in that regard, because what we're trying to do is not necessarily have one system right across the NHS and social care, but actually, can we use the cloud infrastructure in order to make sure that anybody across the NHS, across our health and social care systems that has to access data, has the ability to do so through that cloud-based system. So the sharing of data is incredibly important. And when I look at some of the work of the data strategy, one of the key pillars, so there's 8 priority areas for action. I'll mention a couple of them. One of them is data access. But one of them is also sharing data, which is, you know, high up there as one of the 8 priorities. So, no, I couldn't agree more with Brian Whittle. And if he'd find that session with my officials who are leading on the strategy, I'd be happy to make sure that's arranged.
I would appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary. But I think in terms of, you know, looking at long COVID specifically, and I think that highlights the issues that we were just talking about just now, is that gathering that world-class research that we do have in this country, and gathering that, you know, that data around, you know, for our healthcare professionals around what does long COVID look like, what are the symptoms, and how do we deploy that best in our communities? Because what we know and what we've heard is that practically what's happening on the ground doesn't match, you know, the research that we're doing. So it's how we connect that up. And I'd be really interested to hear, Cabinet Secretary, the work that's being done, because I think that's the start point. That has to be the start point for me. You know, so what work are you currently doing just now to as you say, it's a cloud-based thing. It's gathering all that knowledge together so we can deploy that, you know.
Yeah. So we have a number of research or data points that are important to us. So we've already referenced the ONS study. The EVE2 study is helpful in that regard too. So there's a variety of different data sources. The other thing I've said to my team in We'll have these discussions, obviously, on a Four Nations basis, is also to look at the international data that exists and the international research that exists as well. And we obviously have those nine research projects that I've already mentioned. So accurate local data is obviously required. I've mentioned the international, but local data clearly is required. The strategic network itself, that I've again referenced, has got a dedicated work stream to agree outcomes, indicators, monitoring, evaluation, to accelerate the progress on capturing data, then that's going to help us to inform the planning of our health service provision for those who suffer from long COVID. So again, that national strategic network, which is trying to get that consistency across the country, has that dedicated work stream. I mentioned the EVE2 study. I think you'll know about it. If not, obviously we can provide you detail on that EVE2 long COVID study. And the initial report was published actually just earlier this month on the prevalence of long COVID among adults in Scotland. As well. So again, another helpful data point, but I can see you're indicating to come in, Dr. Harden. So on you go.
Thank you very much. Just on translating research into practice, Mr. Whittle, I think the same NICE RCGP guideline that's been published is quite unique in that it's a living guideline. It's constantly reviewing the research that's published and then incorporating that into updates to the guideline as it goes along. The most recent one that they did, the guideline was fully updated last year, but the process that sits behind that is still ongoing and it's still constantly looking at the research as it's published. Unfortunately, none of the research that has been published has led to any significant update to the guideline as yet, but that process is ongoing. And as we see this research coming to the fore, as it's published, we've already seen the EVE2 study start to be published. There's a number of other studies funded by the CSO's office that are about to probably give their results in the next coming months. And as that data starts to come out from those research studies, sign NICE RCGP guideline will review that evidence and update its guideline, and then that's pushed out into the clinical space as early as possible.
Thank you. I think finally, from my my area here, is the how do we take the knowledge that we're gathering around long COVID into our community and educate our community around what long COVID looks like? Because the other thing we're hearing a lot is that long COVID suffer numbers are an estimate because there's many people not coming forward who have symptoms that could be. It could be long COVID. So how do we take that knowledge and furnish that in our community so they know to come forward?
So we have run a marketing campaign to direct people, obviously, to NHS Inform in relation to some of the symptoms that may be suffering. But I would just refer Brian Whittle to a poll that came out just last month, actually in February, a YouGov poll of 1,001 members of the public. Found that 94% of people had heard of long COVID and 76% of people agreed with the statement that, and I quote, long COVID is a serious condition for those that experience it. So I think there is a good level of understanding of, well, not all the intricacies of long COVID in the way that those around the committee table and particularly sufferers would have, but there's acknowledgement that long COVID exists and also that it can have a serious impact on people's lives. So we'll continue to do more and to make sure that people know about long COVID, but importantly, the services that are available locally to them for it. But that YouGov poll certainly suggests to me that there's a good public awareness of long COVID, at least at a high level.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. John Mason, please.
Hey, thanks so much, Convener. And I take your point that there may be kind of general public awareness of long COVID, but I mean, we continue to have problems that certain sectors of the community are not engaged with health services anyway. Men in more deprived areas hardly ever engage unless there's something very seriously wrong. Again, the vaccine uptake tends to be worse among some ethnic minorities and in poorer areas. So in that kind of area, can we? What are we doing? What can we do to engage with these kind of people who haven't been so engaged in the past?
Yeah, again, it's a really good question. And for me, there has been a lot of learning from the vaccine programme. We have really had to understand where the uptake has been lower and what we do to be able to respond to that. So mobile clinics in areas of higher deprivation, having mobile clinics available in mosques and gurdwaras and temples and so on and so forth. So I think we've got to take that learning from the vaccine programme and make sure that's right across various different parts of health and social care. The UK level survey data indicated that what John Mason says is absolutely right, that the prevalence of self-reported long COVID was greatest in people 35 to 69 years, female, people living in more deprived areas, and those working in social care, going back to Jackie Bailey's point as well. So we know the data is there, and I can just give a guarantee to John Mason that everything we are doing within health and social care is focused, often focused to those areas where we know there is usually accessibility issues, where there are, for example, issues of lower take-up. So it's something that we've learned from the vaccination programme very well, but it's something that we're making sure is right across, embedded right across health and social care approaches that we have.
I wasn't sure if you'd finished your point or not, yeah. I mean, there is a lot of misinformation, and the committee looked at that previously, about vaccines and vaccine damage and things like that. I mean, that's certainly my view. I don't know if you'd agree that, you know, if we could get some simple figures out, like the one I use a lot is still the one that vaccines save 20 million lives. I assume that's gone up, but I still use the 20 million figure. But just some kind of simple messages like that maybe to get through to people, because, I mean, I had somebody come into my office last Friday and still very wary of both of the vaccines, basically, and needing some reassurance, I think.
Yeah, I think we've got to do our best to use the data that we have. So, for example, there was a study out that I'm certain John Mason will know about, that was some World Health Organization commissioned study, I believe. You know, we saved well over 20,000 lives here in Scotland with a vaccination programme. That number, I'm certain, has gone up given the recent autumn-winter booster vaccination programme. So I think it is just about relying on data, or relying on evidence, and trying to counter some of the misinformation. There are some people, I'm afraid, that I think we will almost never be able to convince. I think the vast majority we can, and that will just continue to be relying on the strong evidence base we've got for the vaccination programme. I think the other thing is just using as many different people in society. So people may not trust politicians, shock horror, but we should make sure that we are empowering the clinical voice and clinicians to speak about the benefits. Also, those people who have benefited from the vaccine, of course, all of us, we should make sure they are also speaking about the benefits of the vaccine and the vaccination programme as well. Anything? Yeah, John.
Just on vaccination, there's evidence now coming out that vaccination actually reduces your chance of getting long COVID as well. So that's another reason for individuals to make sure they get their vaccine, particularly in those harder to reach groups, and the more likely susceptible individuals to make sure they get their vaccine. So as we learn more about long COVID, we start to learn about what is the things that can prevent it, and vaccination does seem to be one of those things that does reduce your likelihood of getting long COVID.
Yes, I think we had evidence earlier on that it was primarily a lot of the people with long COVID were people that got COVID before there was a vaccine available. Is that broadly the case?
Pretty much so, yes. It's hard to know because we obviously weren't testing people for COVID at that time, so the kind of link is harder to establish. But yes, we did see a more rapid rise in long COVID cases from the first wave and wild-type virus variants. With subsequent variants, we've seen a less of a rise with each variant, but we have had vaccination in the mix there as well, so it's harder to separate that out.
Okay. And on the kind of theme of educating people, I mean, we'd expect that in the health service and so on, there's a good understanding of long COVID, but a lot of other employers in the private sector and so on may not understand long COVID and what they could and should be doing to support employees. Is there any work going on, or can there be any work going on for that kind of employer, maybe a small employer who doesn't know an awful lot about it?
Yeah, so we are working we are working with Fair Work colleagues and colleagues in employment around long COVID. I have to say, again, there are issues. I've certainly had long COVID sufferers come up to me to tell me that they have not had the most supportive employer. And of course, we are working with a variety of organisations to try to help and assist in that regard to get the messaging out there. For me, though, I've been heartened to say that the majority of interactions around business I've had is that people have felt supported by their employer in relation to COVID and long COVID. But that's not universal and it's not consistent enough. So, yes, we are engaging with employment colleagues. Perhaps I can ask colleagues in employment to write to the convener and give you more detail around the specific actions they're taking with employers in relation to long COVID, if that's helpful.
OK, thanks. And, I mean, one of the themes that kind of has come through this inquiry has been comparisons with ME. And, you know, clearly ME has been around for, I don't know, 40 years, or has been recognised at least for that kind of length of time. And I think, I mean, we probably all know sufferers from ME. And, again, we've never really reached, you know, a cure or, you know, one thing, one answer for ME. And it's been very difficult to pin down. I mean, is it your feeling that in the, basically that's what we're, where we're going with long COVID, that it's going to be continue to be incredibly difficult to pin down and we probably are not going to get just one simple solution?
So I'm going to go to the clinician to give a response to that, because it wouldn't be right for me to, without clinical knowledge, to assert what I think will happen in relation to long COVID and its comparison to ME, CFS as well, chronic fatigue syndrome, because there are clearly some similarities in relation to how that's presented. The disbelief, I think, the Murdo Fraser referenced it in his question, that's something we sometimes hear from ME and CFS sufferers as well. But if you don't mind, in terms of the clinical the question that you ask, really I should pass, I think, to the clinician, Dr. Harden, to maybe give a view on that.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. With regards ME/CFS, there's huge amounts of research still ongoing to understand fundamentally what is behind ME/CFS. There is parallels with some aspects of long COVID and ME/CFS, and that's not surprising because there is an association with ME/CFS and previous viral infection. And we know that certain viruses do lead you to be more likely to develop ME/CFS. So I would imagine that there will be a significant proportion of people who have long COVID are likely to have similar type symptoms to ME/CFS just because they've had a significant viral episode or they've had a viral illness. That being said, the research is now showing that there's multiple pathologies sitting behind the symptoms that people get with from long COVID. A recent article in Nature broke them down into five different pathological processes, all with overlapping symptoms and signs. And the difficulty there is, until we know how much each one plays in what symptoms and in what patients, it's very difficult to know how best to then treat those individuals, because you have to find out what's their symptoms, are they linked to long COVID, what pathology is going on in their body, and then treat it with the treatment that works for that particular type of pathology. And I'm guessing the chances are that we will find that it's not just one pathology process going on in individuals, it will be multiple in the one individual at the same time. So you're asking me to delve into my crystal ball as a clinician. I'm a perpetual optimist, and I think that medicine, we've seen medicine come on leaps and bounds in its strive to tackle the COVID pandemic. And I think that if you think about where the NHS and medicine was 75 years ago when the NHS was founded to now, it's a whole different situation, and I think that will continue. We will develop treatments for diseases, but sometimes it will take longer than others depending on the complexity of the illness.
OK, thanks very much.
Thank you very much. We do have a little bit of time. If I may just go back to one of the questions that Jackie Bailey touched on earlier, and it was the impact of health and social care services. Do we have any figures or numbers on the amount of NHS or social care staff that are currently off work as a result of long COVID, and what action is being taken to address this?
Yeah, I think we should be able to get those figures to you, so forgive me, I don't have my fingertips right in front of me, but we might be able to get those figures to you, and if I'm able to give them, I'm happy to share them, of course, with you, convener, and then to share with the rest of the committee. I think that should be possible, but if you don't mind, I'll take that one off table and see what we can provide.
That'll be great. I'm going to open up to members for supplementaries. Brian, did you want to come in?
Thank you, Kevin. I was thinking of a point that Murdo Fraser made. He raised the issue of long COVID clinics and the potential advantages or disadvantages of long COVID clinics. I wonder if one of the considerations you might have, Cabinet Secretary, is if we have long COVID clinics where those with long COVID or potentially have long COVID coalesce around that, is our ability then to gather data, because we know where people with long COVID are, so maybe one of the advantages of a long COVID clinic.
It could be, but I don't think, you know, in the absence of a clinic, we should take our foot off the pedal at all in relation to that data gathering, because I agree essentially with the first point that you made in your questioning to me, which is that data is going to be vital in order to improve our services that we're providing. I think my challenge around long COVID clinics is that it feels to me, and what I've seen and what I've read around the different models across the UK, and it's fair to say that there's different models in the UK, there's not just kind of one long COVID clinic model, is that they for me tend to essentially end up being a bit of a middleman. It's like the Oscars, when you've talked too much, the music comes on and they tell you to get off. There was no need for that, Miss Bailey. There's no need for that. So there could be that advantage about coalescing, but I don't think it's necessary in the sense that, you know, if I look at the Lanarkshire model, we've had about 585 or thereabouts, well over 500 referrals. So there's a kind of rich data source in one sense. Ashley, yeah.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to add to that how the evaluation tool that's going to be developed by NSS will be incredibly helpful with this. Basically, as we've kind of already outlined, essentially long COVID is a new illness and new disease. We've got to learn a lot about it and also what works. So we're hoping that the evaluation tool being developed will give us more of a picture, both nationally but also locally, around what kind of people are getting long COVID, what the impact is on them, the impact of our services too, and shed more light into what's working and also, more importantly, what's not working. So that will definitely be helping us to collect more data across Scotland. It will also hopefully help with the health inequalities aspect as well. We're keen that that evaluation tool will show us what demographics current services are working for, and also who's not being engaged and where we're not having the most impact that our services could possibly have. And then more importantly, it will give us that evidence base for us to adapt and also learn from what's working, and to encourage other health boards to pick up those useful services, I suppose.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions from members? No? Okay. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 30th of March, when we will be considering our work programme and an approach paper for the recovery of NHS Dentistry Services Inquiry. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave, and I move the meeting into private. Thank you.
Thank you.